Hello, my name is Pastor Tim Brewington, and I am the pastor of Fellowship Church. At Fellowship Church, we're just ordinary people who have experienced extraordinary life in Jesus Christ. And our mission is to tell others what we have experienced so that they too can experience this wonderful Jesus that we serve. I would like to send a personal invitation to you, your friends, and your family to join us at one of our worship services. You will find that we are a community of believers that focus on the Word of God, worship, and praise. During our worship services, we believe in just letting the Holy Spirit have His way. So please, join us at one of our worship services. God bless you.
Thank you, Lord. Would you turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 19, the 19th chapter of Luke. And we're reading, you're hearing the first 9 verses. Luke chapter 19, 19th chapter of Luke. And we will read the first 9 verses in your hearing. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, Luke chapter 19, beginning at verse 1. Then Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. Now behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, who was a chief tax collector, and he was rich. And he sought to see who Jesus was, but could not because of the crowd, for he was of short stature. So he ran ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was going to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said to him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must stay at your house. So he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. But when they saw it, they all complained, saying he is going to be a guest with a man who is a sinner. Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, Look, Lord, I give half of my goods to the poor. And if I have taken anything from anyone by false accusation, I restore fourfold. And Jesus said to him, Today salvation has come to this house, because he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we do thank you for your goodness and your mercy unto us. We thank you for another opportunity that we have to come together and to hear a word from you. I pray that your word will go forth with clarity and power, and those that are hearers and doers of the word, their life will change forever because of what they have heard today. Holy Spirit, have your way in this place. Break through every barrier, pull down every stronghold, set free every mind and heart that is bound by anything, in the name of Jesus Christ. I sense your presence here, and I know whenever you are here, you have an agenda. There's something you want to do. There's something you want to make happen. So we say collectively, have your way. Have your way. Have your way. Hallelujah. Every heart is open. Every mind is open. Every spirit is ready to receive. Have your way. In this place, Lord Jesus, we thank you in advance. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You presence of the Lord. When we approach this text, we come to a man named Zacchaeus.
Yes.
And in the first couple of verses of this text, there are three things that we learn about Zacchaeus. The first thing we learn is that he is a chief tax collector. Mm-hmm. Now, some of us already have an attitude with him just because he's a chief tax collector, which means that he is good at getting money to the government. He just wasn't an average tax collector, but he was a chief tax collector. He was a friend of the Roman Empire in that he was good at making sure that they got their money. But the Bible says not only was he the chief tax collector, but he was also rich, which means that he was also good at keeping some of that money for himself. Because every tax collector in the Bible wasn't rich, but the Bible makes a point here that this man was a rich man. Now, I'll give you full context here that many of the Jews didn't like the tax collectors because they were thieves, and we see in the text that the Jews called him a sinner. And the way that they would become rich is if your tax bill was $100, they would tell you your tax bill is $150. They give 100 to the Roman Empire and keep 50 for themselves. And that's how they became rich. And then the third thing, the Bible says that he was short. Now, I don't know anybody else in the Bible who is described as short. So there is something, of short stature, not to offend anybody who verbally challenged this morning. The Bible makes a point that this man was short. So as I look through this text, I discovered that there are four lessons that we can learn from a short man. And so I'm going to talk to you about lessons we can learn from a short man. The first lesson we find in verses 3 and 4, let's read that again. It says that he sought to see who Jesus was, but could not because of the crowd, for he was of short stature. So what did he do? So he ran ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was going to pass that way. So the first lesson that we learn from a short man is do not let your shortcomings or your limitations stop you from seeing Jesus. This man, he didn't allow his shortcomings to stop him from being the chief tax collector, and he didn't allow his shortcomings to stop him from ripping people off. And when he heard that Jesus was in town, he did not let his shortcomings stop him from seeing Jesus. So he heard that Jesus was in town. So he went to the place where Jesus was. And when he got there, he couldn't see Jesus because he was so short. Now we have to make a point about his shortness. Historians believe that he probably had some form of dwarfism. For them to make a point that with all those people in the crowd, he couldn't see over anybody. He was the shortest man in the crowd. And he got to the moment where he could see Jesus. He was right there at the point where Jesus was, and he couldn't see him because he was short. Have you ever had a significant moment in your life when things can change forever and get right to that moment and you fall up short, you come up short. You get to that moment and you realize that your limitation may stop you from seeing what you want to see. Some kids are familiar with this. You get to the amusement park, you get to the ride that you want to ride, you're all excited about getting on the ride, and right before you get on the ride, measuring stick, and if you're not taller than that stick, you can't get on the ride. You come up short, so you miss the opportunity to enjoy something that other people are enjoying. When Zacchaeus got to this place to see Jesus, and he couldn't see him because of his limitation, he had three options. The first option, he could have stayed there and just complained about all of the tall people who were getting in his way. He could have stood there and said, y'all are so rude and disrespectful. You got to see me back here. I'm trying to see Jesus, and you are blocking my way. He could have stayed there, made a scene, and still not been able to see Jesus. That was one option. He had another option that some of us take. His second option is that he could have just went home and spent the rest of his life blaming everybody else for why he couldn't see Jesus. 20 years later, he could still be talking about, remember when Jesus was in town 20 years ago and I went down there to see him and all those tall people got in my way? Now he's an old man. He's talking to his grandchildren. 50 years ago, I had an opportunity to see Jesus and I went down there and all those tall people stopped me from seeing Jesus. He could have spent the rest of his life blaming everybody else because he missed an opportunity to see Jesus. Who are we blaming for missed opportunities in our life? Third thing he could have did, which is what he did, he could have figured out a way to see Jesus in spite of his shortcomings, which is exactly what he did. We read the text. The Bible says he did two things. The first thing the Bible says he did was he ran ahead of the crowd. He said, I can't do anything about my height, but I know how to run. He said, I can't change the way that I was born. I can't change the circumstances that I was born in, but I will do what I know how to do. I know how to run. Maybe if I run fast enough, my little feet will do for me what my short legs cannot do. My feet can get me to the place where I can see Jesus. Sometimes the best thing you can have is a limitation. Because when you have a limitation, you have to be creative. You have to figure out a way to get it done. When everything is handed to you, you don't have to work for anything and you don't appreciate anything. But if you have a limitation, that will force you to figure it out. Find another way. He said, I may not be tall, but I know how to run. Somewhere it is. Running, he figured out, even if I get ahead of the crowd, I'm still not going to see Jesus when he gets here. So being ahead of the crowd is not enough. So I need to get above the crowd. Oh, sometimes being ahead of the crowd is not enough. Sometimes you have to go above the crowd. So the Bible says that he saw a sycamore tree. Now, sycamore tree produces figs. But the sycamore tree also grows to be up to 175 feet. So there was his answer. He said, I may not be tall enough to see Jesus, but I know how to run and I know how to climb trees. So he ran ahead of the crowd. He climbed the tree. You know what he did? He put himself in a position to see Jesus. He figured out a way to put himself in the place where he could see Jesus. He decided that he was not going to allow his limitation that he could do nothing about stop him from seeing Jesus. You know what he did? When he climbed up that sycamore tree, he figured out a way how to get over whatever was blocking him from seeing Jesus. I'm not going to stay here too long, but we have got to learn how to figure out how to get over whatever it is blocking us from seeing Jesus. All of us have limitations. All of us are fighting something, dealing with something. All of us have things in our past or in our future, but we have a choice. If we want to see Jesus, we need to do whatever we have to do Lesson number one, don't allow your limitations to stop you from seeing Jesus. Lesson number two is found in verses 5 and 6. The Bible says that when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said to him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must stay at your house. So he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. Lesson number two. When you do all that you can do to get over your limitations so that you can see Jesus, Jesus will exceed your expectation. Oh, I'm trying to tell you this morning, it will be worth the fight. Whatever you have to forgive, whatever you have to let go, whatever you need to move away from, whatever you need to resign from, whatever you need to do to get to see Jesus, I promise you this morning, it will be well worth it. Jesus will exceed your expectation. Look at the text. Look at what happened to this man. All he wanted that day was to see Jesus. But three additional things happened to him on that day. He saw Jesus, but guess what? Jesus saw him. Oh man, it's one thing for you to notice Jesus. It's another thing for Jesus to notice you. Hallelujah. Jesus saw a lot of people in the crowd, but the text said Jesus looked up. His disadvantage gave him an advantage over everybody else. Jesus looked up and saw him. Hallelujah. See, what you call a disadvantage is an advantage. Oh yes, because sometimes your limitations, your pains, and your hurts will force your knees to the floor to cause you to pray and seek Jesus. And anybody who is seeking Jesus, especially through trouble, you are at an advantage, not a disadvantage. You are at an advantage. So not only did he see Jesus, but Jesus saw him. That was more than what he expected. But that wasn't it. Not only did he see Jesus and Jesus saw him, but Jesus called him by name. Yeah. Jesus said, Zacchaeus. He didn't even know that Jesus knew his name. Here he is, this short man, running ahead of the crowd, climbing trees just to see Jesus, come to find out that Jesus called him by name. Can I tell you, when Jesus calls you by name, everything changes. Jesus didn't just say, hey, Zacchaeus, I see you up there. I see you, man. No. Jesus said, today, I'm coming to your house. This man, in a moment, went from having a limitation that could have kept him from seeing Jesus to having an invitation to have Jesus at his house. Oh man, oh man. Can I just tell you, when I see this, when I hear this, the way I understand it, I appreciate it, is that there are a lot of men in the gospel and women that I have much respect for. But there are two that I have studied for years, and I've listened to their messages, and one is Charles Stanley, and the other one is John Piper. Now, Charles Stanley graduated from the same seminary that I graduated from. When I graduated from seminary, we had our graduation in his church. Now, Charles Stanley was not there on that day, but I was glad just to be in the house that he pastors. I've had several times to go to John Piper's church and listen to him preach. And I remember the first time I went there, I was with a friend who was late. You got to choose your friends wisely. It's important to me. Choose a friend that's not late, okay? But anyway, I thought that was a disadvantage, but it actually worked out to my advantage because we got there late, so they put us up in the balcony, in the section of the balcony. I was looking like right at John Piper, and I was good with that. And then I imagine when I read this text, what would I have done? Because all I wanted to do is see and hear John Piper. And I thought to myself, how would I have responded if in the middle of his sermon, he looked up at me in the balcony and said, hey, Tim, I'm going to go out tonight. Imagine the surprise. Imagine, here he is. I barely got there, and now I'm having dinner with John Piper. That's what happened to Zacchaeus. All he wanted was to see Jesus. And he ended up having a personal visitation with Jesus. I come to tell you that if you seek Jesus, he will not only see you, call your name, but he will give you a home visit. Hallelujah. Your expectation. Lesson three from a short man named Zacchaeus, we find in verse 7. Verse 7 says, but when they saw it, they all complained. When they saw it, they all complained, saying, he has gone to be a guest with a man who is a sinner. Lesson number one. Don't allow your limitations to keep you from seeing Jesus. Lesson number two, Jesus will exceed your expectation. Lesson number three, don't allow what they say stop you from seeing Jesus.
Oh, yes.
Don't allow what they say. The Bible says, but when they saw it, they complained. They, the tall people, the people who didn't have to do anything extra to see Jesus. The people who took advantage of the fact that they were tall, that Jesus was in their view. They didn't have to run. They didn't have to climb a tree. But they had something to say about the fact that Jesus was visiting a man who desired to see him so much that he ran ahead of everybody and climbed a tree, and they had a problem with it. Let me tell you, you have to learn not to live your life based upon what they say.
Right.
All of us got some things in our life. Every time we move in the positive direction, they have something to say. And let me tell you, you will lose your mind listening to what they say. Because they say one thing today and another thing tomorrow. When you do good, they complain. When you don't do good, they complain. This man ignored what they say. He had a personal invitation with Jesus, and he couldn't care less what they had to say. Can I help somebody? Some of us care too much about what they have to say. They don't know what you have to go through to get to the place where you are this morning. They don't know what you have to tell yourself to get out of bed in the morning. They don't know what you have to do to make it during the day. And Jesus has come and made a personal invitation, and you are going to allow what they say to stop you from fellowshipping with Jesus. You need to get over what they say. They say, lesson four is going to be done for today. Lesson four, verses 8, 9, and 10. Then Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, look, I give half of my goods to the poor. And if I had taken anything from anyone by false accusation, I restore fourfold. Verse 9. And Jesus said to him, today salvation comes to this house, because he also is a son of Abraham. Verse 10. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which is lost.
Amen.
Here's lesson 4. When you spend time with Jesus, he will confirm your true identity. When you spend time with Jesus, he will confirm your true identity. In verse 7, they call him a sinner. But in verse 9, Jesus called him a son of Abraham. Yes. Lord have mercy. They had a problem with him because the tax collectors were also of Jewish descent. So they were brothers. Imagine you have an adversary that's taxing you, and your brother comes to your house representing your oppressor and says, give me the money so I can give to the one who is oppressing us. That's why they called him a sinner. He said, you're not a part of us anymore. Because of what you have done, you are no longer invited to the family reunion. We are disowning you, because in their mind there were two groups of people. Either you are a son of Abraham or you are a sinner. There's no in between. And so he was rejected as a sinner. But Jesus, notice, not only here's lesson 5, but I didn't realize until this moment. When you do what you have to do to get to see Jesus, Jesus will defend you. Notice in the text, the people called him a sinner, but Zacchaeus didn't address them at all. He didn't say anything to them. It was Jesus who looked at them and said, all of you all who think you are saved, guess what? Salvation is coming to his house.
Amen.
And guess what? He too is a son. That you didn't have to say anything. Spend time with Jesus and he will defend you. You don't have to defend yourself. He looked at the man's accusers and said, guess what? Salvation, deliverance, and hope is coming to his house.
Hallelujah.
To God, don't you allow people to say something to you that caused you to miss the salvation that's on its way to your house. I'm closing here. But Jesus clarifies why he came. He says, understand, the Son of Man has come to seek and save those who are lost. Understand why he came. He came looking for the lost, so that he could save the lost.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
So guess what? If you are a sinner, you qualify for the reason Jesus came. If you are lost outside of fellowship with him, you are the one that Jesus came for. So all the tall, self-righteous people who think you have it all together just because you had it easy, you didn't have to go through anything. Jesus said, no, y'all got it twisted. This man is a son of Abraham too, and I'm coming to save his house. His house, stand to your feet, please. Doesn't matter matter what they say. What matters is what Jesus says. I want to help somebody today. You must reject what they have said about you and embrace what Jesus says about you. There is no greater pursuit or search than to pursue and search for Jesus. Read the text again. The Bible says that on that day, Zacchaeus wanted to see who Jesus was, which meant that he had heard something about Jesus, and he wanted to see for himself who he is. The greatest debate that humanity has ever had is the question of who is Jesus. More books have been written about Jesus Christ. More debates have been started over Jesus Christ than any other historical figure in history. There is no greater pursuit than the pursuit of Jesus. When you are pursuing him, it may cost you everything. Let's not skip over verse number 18. When Zacchaeus says, listen, because of what I found, because of what I have figured out, I'm giving away half of everything I own. Because of who I see today, because of what is happening today, I'm willing to give up half of what I own. And he said, if, and that's interesting that he said, if I've ripped anybody off. But he said, if I ripped anybody off, I'm going to pay them back fourfold. Mm-hmm. Oh, because when you come in contact with Jesus, everything changes. When you come in contact with Jesus, it's not about what you possess. It's about reconciliation. It's about getting things right with God and with man. Can I tell you, you want to be right with God, you have to be right with man also. Some of us are good at being right with God, but we're not right with each other. You got to spend some more time with Jesus. Because guess what? When Jesus called him the son of Abraham, that means that all of them, all the things, they had to receive him again as their brother. Because they too were children of Abraham. As you seek him, you will have to confront your shortcomings and your limitations. And all of us have them. Some of us it's physical. Some of us it's economical, social, cultural, even theological. You know, your theological perspective can be limiting and prevent you from seeing who Jesus really is. So what do we do? What do we do in these times? What do we do? We do whatever we have to do. Hear me. Do whatever you have to do to see Jesus. You know what? Like Zacchaeus, some of us, we get over our limitations when it comes to career. We do whatever we have to do for work. We do whatever we have to do for our businesses. We do whatever we have to do for worldly success. But when it comes to Jesus, we say, well, I would, but I had a bad upbringing. Now, your bad upbringing didn't keep you from being successful at your job. But when it comes to Jesus, you say, no, I got too many shortcomings. I got too many limitations. I can't see Jesus like that. My brothers and my sisters, I don't know who God is talking to, but God is saying, I want to come to your house. I want to visit you. I want to change your name. I want to reveal your true identity because you have accepted what they say and rejected what I say. Accept what I say about you. Hallelujah to God. Hallelujah to God. Lord Jesus, we thank you today for your word that has been spoken to us. We thank you, Lord, because this type of word comes to us to let us know that you're trying to get our attention, that you see us, you notice us, but you want to reveal yourself to us in a greater way. So I pray today, God, as we have listened to this message today, that we would leave here determined not to allow any of our limitations or shortcomings stop us from seeing you. We want to know who you are. Hallelujah. We don't want to serve the God of our imagination, but we want to serve the true and living God. We want to see you, God, in our circumstances. We want to see you in our homes and in our families. We want to see you in this community. No matter what it is that we are going through, God, we want to see you. Give us the heart of Zacchaeus. We're pursuing you is our chief aim and goal. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ. Touch right now. We need a touch from you. Hallelujah. Look upon us. Look in our direction today. Like you saw Zacchaeus and you called him by name, call us by name today, God. In the name of Jesus. We thank you and praise you for you now. In Jesus' name is prayed. Amen. Hallelujah. And worship the Lord for a few minutes and then go dismiss. Worship him. Hallelujah, Jesus. Tell him you want to see him.
You got it.
to be lifted by the power of God. So I'm glad I need you. Hallelujah. Oh, y'all don't like that talk. We live in a society where they don't want us to admit our weaknesses. But guess what? I admit I have some weaknesses. And I thank God for my weaknesses, because it is through those weaknesses that I experience the power of God. So I'd like to call, I joy in my weakness.
Upon you.
My name is Tim Brewington, and I am the pastor of Fellowship Church. Thank you for viewing this broadcast today. For more information about Fellowship Church, please check us out at www.thefellowshipmn.org. God bless you.